Finally, a summary debunking Nathan Thompson's Flat Earth Flyer. If this is the first time you're watching my video, well, welcome dear viewer. This is a series where I take a look at one of Flat Earth Flyer and discuss / debunk one section at a time, and this is the summary video. So for all 10 points, it would be a quick TLDR, and if YouTube allows it, I'll have all 10 videos come up as cards. Anyway, they will be listed in description. Each video goes into a lot more details, so for any point you're unclear on or want more information, please check those out. This also gives me a way to correct or clarify some points I had made on my earlier videos, and points that I have skipped due to time constraints. It's all time coded just in case you want to skip. Point 1. Water is a natural level. No curvature is ever detected over bodies of water. All liquids, when undisturbed, are flawlessly flat. Well, 71% of the Earth connected as one large body of water. I'm assuming that sentence means all this water is at the same level, i.e. the same height. However, in real life, we find water to have different sea levels around the world due to gravitational pull. Water near Darwin, Australia has a different sea level than in Sri Lanka. We call this local sea level, and not to be confused with global sea level, which is an average of all water basins. So no, all liquids when undisturbed are flawlessly flat is not correct in this context. Point 2. Airplane level flights. The FAA assumes a flat Earth when training pilots using their target generation facility. An airplane traveling 500 miles per hour would have to compensate for a drop of 2,777 feet every minute to maintain cruising altitude and not fly off into space. On my original video, I explained how it is not possible to fly off into space even if a pilot wanted to, followed by how a plane works, including altitude meter using barometric pressure to calculate it. Next, calling it a drop is very, very misleading. In essence, in a round Earth, if the aircraft is maintaining the same altitude, as far as the people on board, there is no drop. I talked about how on a small two-seater plane like Cessna 172, without any autopilot feature, we have to use trim to keep our plane level using VSI or vertical speed indicator. This also uses barometric pressure to measure this value. Supposing there are no external variables that can change our altitude, and we simply go with 90 degree nose dip when traveling over one quarter of the Earth. In my original video, I used an elevation of zero. That was simply because if I did the calculation based on 30 km, some would complain that Cessna 172 doesn't cruise at that altitude. Thus, by using a zero elevation only works in my favor, as the higher the altitude, the longer the arc distance, thus helping my equation. Earth's circumference is 21,639 nautical miles, so about 5,409 nautical miles is one quarter. So without external variables, I would need to adjust my trim by 1 degree over 60.1 nautical miles. On our trusty Cessna 172, at optimal cruise speed, that would take around 30 minutes. Even a long-distance commercial passenger aircraft typically cruises at maximum 500 knots, which means it would take over 7.2 minutes for this 1 degree change. That was my original script. I want to clarify it in this video. I am talking about a gradual change. On my Cessna 172, I'm looking at my VSI throughout the whole 30 minutes to ensure it's zero. Now, the actual pitch of the aircraft at that point depends on many variables, including airspeed, flaps, and so on. If there were no other variables, this pitch would then depend on our altitude. Unless I'm a really bad pilot, trust me, you will not feel this gradual change. Point 3. Science says it's stationary. every scientific experiment has proven Earth is completely stationary. The Sun, Moon, and stars move around polar center above us. Research North Star, Michelson-Morley, Sagnac experiment, and Eris failure. TLDR, we know Polaris was not always the North Star. 5,000 years ago, it was Thuban, a relatively inconspicuous star in the constellation Draco the Dragon, was the pole star. In year 4000, we would be calling Eri our North Star. Fast forward to 7500. That honor would belong to Eldarimin. We have observed the constellation to move since ancient times, and that was one of their points. We know from the planet's movement that Sun, Moon, and stars do not move around polar center above us. In phase, geocentric model even came up with the concept of epicycle to explain retrograde motion before giving up. We talked about all the three theories mentioned and how they were trying to prove the existence of ether. In fact, one of the experiments they mentioned, Sagnac experiment, is the basis of our laser gyroscope, the same technology flat earthers tried to use to prove that the Earth didn't rotate.
But what we found is when we turned on that gyroscope, we found that we were picking up a drift, a 15 degree per hour drift.
Now, who wants to guess what the response would have been if the gyroscope returns zero? It's funny how they're willing to accept science when it fits their narrative. Point 4. Horizon is always eye level. Not only is the horizon is always flat to the observer, but it rises to eye level. High-altitude amateur balloon footage without a fisheye or GoPro lens always shows a flat Earth. Well, yes, horizon is always eye level. I have explained why it is and how it is applicable to both globe and flat Earth, so it neither proves or disproves. I have also talked about why wide viewing angle is necessary to view the curvature and how lens distortion works. And finally, the statement is false, as there are balloon footage with lens that is not as wide as GoPro lens. Point 5. We see too far. Mount Canigou in France is seen 175 miles away. According to the curvature formula of Earth, 8 inch per mile square, the peak should be 3000 feet below the horizon. Infrared is very revealing. So yes, it is true. But at the same time, you only get to see it less than 3 months in a year under certain weather conditions. Refraction is how this magic happens. This is the reason why we see sunrise and sunset before or after it actually happened. You can see similar phenomenon like Corsica being seen from Monaco during early morning. If you don't buy it, well, I ain't selling. But do ask yourself the following question. If something looks the way it does, only at certain times, under a certain condition, can there be some other explanations why it looks like so? If not, what is the explanation for how it looks like the rest of the time? Point 6. The dome is real. There are lots of proof we live under a dome. Sundogs, halos, rainbows, and star trails all prove this. You can't have a vacuum resting next to a pressurized atmosphere without a barrier. Even NASA admits they can no longer live low Earth orbit, but they could in 1969? Well, yes, you can have an atmosphere next to a vacuum, as we clearly have. The problem is, you think full to nothing in one step, where it is more a gradual change that involves gravity and escape velocity of object. Sundogs, halos are refraction and prism effect from a specific type of shape formed by ice crystal, and thus we don't see it all the time. It has a certain requirements, where rainbows are due to prism effect in water droplets. Applying that to your dome model, well, I would say sundogs are only possible where the light is shining from outside the dome, and the side lights are the reflection from dome side. In which case, are there people living outside that dome? And do they know that they are outside the dome? Sundogs, rainbow, and such depends on the environment from your perspective. Thus, the way a rainbow appears to you is not the same to someone else in a different location. If it was all due to a dome, and those two people were close enough compared to the size of the Earth, it would look the same. But in reality, it looks different. Star trails. Well, some stars we only see in Northern Hemisphere. And during the year, they appear at different position. We have the same in Southern Hemisphere. Looking at you, Southern Cross. Over time, we see different constellations. Please give us a flat Earth model that can explain all that. On a heliocentric model, it all works out perfectly. NASA's statement is just wrong, and my inability to summarize it means, well, please check my full video. Sorry. Point 7, moonlight is cold. A laser thermometer proves moonlight is colder than in the shade. This fact indicates that moon is not a reflector of the sun's light, but rather a light source in and of itself. Well, no, it's not. In my full video, I explain the issues with the so-called experiments, followed by how to do it correctly with all the control variables with my prediction. TLDR? It's called radiative cooling. In essence, the shade you're measuring, well, during day it is what keeps the area cool, and at night, it helps less heat from escaping into the space. So if you do the same test on a moonless night, you'd get the same result. Thus, it shows nothing. Now, my background is not physics. And to be brutally honest, I do not know enough about thermodynamics to be confident enough to talk to you about it. From a layman's perspective, it has something to do with entropy, which means cold can never travel to hot. The only thing I know about thermodynamics that you can't cheat it. It's as certain as taxes and death, though not as catchy. If you want to know more, well, Thunderfoot is a YouTuber I can definitely recommend. Point 8. Crepuscular sun rays. The sun is smaller than Earth and very close. We can trace the angle of rays back to their sources above the clouds. The sun is clearly not massive or 93 million miles away, but small and relatively close. Well, you can calculate the distance from the variables presented. In my original video, I have shown various images of God rays. There is one taken inside a cave and one taken in a forest. Now, if you decide to draw a line from the rays to a point, you will find that you get a different height for the light source. Now, let's go with option 1. That is, your method is indeed correct. So when you see the light source closer, the sun is really closer to you. But not only you, but everyone else around the planet. Question. Did the sun come close in just that one occurrence, or is it repeatable? So when you're seeing that God ray, someone else is seeing a really large sun. Now when the sun is closer, in a flat plane, would that not mean the light would spread less, meaning the place that would be getting sunlight is no longer getting it? Also, what happens with the season? Does it get warmer? Or does sun have nothing to do with season? Simply put, sun being so far away, the rays are almost parallel, as seen from outside the Earth's atmosphere. Now blame your viewpoint and the Earth's atmosphere for what you're seeing. In my original video, I didn't talk about the actual distance to sun. Well, it was a video talking about how God rays cannot be used to measure the distance. The distance from Earth to Sun is 150.98 million kilometers. Now, from my understanding, Greek astronomer Hipparchus in 2nd century BCE used the method known today as parallax to calculate the distance to Moon. He did a remarkable job and came to within 7% of today's calculated value. Another Greek astronomer, Aristarchus, around the year 250 BC, hypothesized that a half moon would mean all these three bodies would form a right triangle. The problem was, we only knew one value and we need one more to figure out the triangle. Aristarchus decided to estimate the angle between moon and sun, and he came quite close, 87 degrees, where in reality it is 89.83 degrees. because of the huge distance, the small error got magnified and his results were off by a factor of more than 1,000. Finally, in 1653, astronomer Christian Huygens calculated the distance from Earth to the Sun. He used the phases of Venus to find the angles in a Venus-Earth-Sun triangle. The advantage Venus had over Moon was, well, it was going across different parts of the Sun, giving us enough data points for our final value. Point 9. Gravity is magic. Newton's theory has never been proven. Gravity is easily explained by density and buoyancy. Things rise and fall based on their density and the medium in which they are traveling through. So, yes, the theory has never been proven. No, gravity cannot be explained with density as it's a property and not a force, i.e. a vector with magnitude and direction. It's not buoyancy either, as you might claim air to be the fluid to cause the force buoyancy. But that doesn't explain why it is falling what we call down. Furthermore, in a vacuum where there is practically no air, why does a feather and a bowling ball fall? There is no medium. Furthermore, why do they fall at the same rate? Gravity is not magic. But yet, it can explain it all. And that theory can never be proven due to, well, check my full video for that. Things that I have missed in my original video. Well, I talked about things dropping, but not about things that happens to float or fly. How come a helium balloon or a bird flies, or a dandelion or a feather float? Is that not buoyancy? Well, no. Just for simplicity, let's separate those into two groups. One is the one we can visibly see making an effort to remain afloat, like bees or birds flapping its wings or aircraft using thrust. On the other group, we have things like helium and such, things we cannot visibly see. Let's start with what I know most and is my personal hobby, flying. Well, in the first group, they all generate lift in various ways. The aircraft uses a wing design that forces the air to flow faster below the wing compared to above the wing. That generates the lift. There are four forces of flight: weight, lift, drag, and thrust. When it comes to bird, well, they flap their wings to generate enough thrust. Some birds may use gravity, for example, jumping from a tree, to give them forward thrust for flight. Others may use a running takeoff from the ground. And the other group? Well, it really comes down to the displacement. For example, for helium balloon, as long as the weight of the helium plus the balloon fiber is lighter than the air it displaces, the balloon will float in the air. As helium is a lot lighter than air, if you were to fill a 1-liter soda bottle full with helium, the bottle would weigh about 1 gram less than the same bottle filled with air. That doesn't sound like much, but in large volumes, the 1 gram per liter difference between air and helium really adds up. Now, before you call bullshit, this is not only limited to air. This displacement is the reason of the famous Eureka by Archimedes, which states that when a body is immersed in a liquid, it experiences an upward buoyant force, which is equal to the weight of the liquid displaced by the body. In fact, buoyancy explains why some objects float and others don't. Point 10. Boats over the curve. It is a common misconception that boats disappear out of sight because of the curvature of Earth. The introduction of the Nikon P900 and P1000 have posed a real problem for the supposed curve of the Earth. Just zoom in. Well, we actually said boats disappear out of sight from bottom up because of the curvature of the Earth. So even when you use a Nikon P1000, you will still have the boats disappear from bottoms up. On my full video, I do talk about perspective and refraction, what causes us to see a certain distance, and what zoom does, and so on. TLDR, for our brains or optics to register two different points, well, they need to have an angle that is more than angular resolution for our eyes. Anything less than that specified angle, well, we can't tell the difference. Zoom or magnification allows us to limit our viewing angle, i.e. bring the object closer to our view, but has the same drawback. Which basically means, you cannot see something with naked eye, you might be able to see it using a Nikon P1000. If you can't see it with a P1000, well, maybe one day you'll be able to see it with a P10,000. One of my examples were a floating pillar, half painted red and the other half painted yellow. On a globe model, at one point, you will only see the red with naked eye. Because the horizon and the yellow-red marker is less than the angle you can perceive. At that moment, if you bring out a Nikon P1000, granted, you will see some yellow. And that's the keyword, some. You will not see the full yellow, where you will see the full red. After a while, you will see no yellow. Bring out your P10,000. You have some yellow. Rinse and repeat. At this point, I want to take a moment and explain my motivation behind these videos. I don't expect hardcore flat earthers to come across my videos and all of a sudden start believing in a globe earth. Oh no. But I expect those sitting on a fence or wants to know more to present them with facts and logic in a simple way. Start with the basic questions from what we observe. From my home, I don't get to see the horizon thanks to all the bloody buildings in the way. But I do experience day and night. I have summer and winter. That's about it in UK. When I look at the stars, I know there are some stars I'm just not seeing. There are some stars that I can only see during some times of the year. Let's start with a model that can explain day, night, season, constellations to start with, right? Once we have achieved that, only then maybe we should look at other things. I have just the thing. It's called heliocentric model. This whole series has been all about debunking the claims of flat earthers and not much about the proof of a globe earth. I did mention various experiments throughout this series. Now all I can do is promise to you that I will have a video soon with a compilation of all the methods you can use at home to prove a globe earth. Well, that's all for this video. Thank you so much for watching. If you have enjoyed this content, well, a like and a comment won't go amiss. If you'd also subscribe for future contents like this, it would definitely help my small channel grow and would be thoroughly appreciated. Have a safe day. Signing off. We are one team.